Hi children. So under NEET JEE lecture series, this is lecture number 11. In this lecture, I am going to discuss stable and unstable equilibrium cases. Stable and unstable equilibrium. Actually, these concepts have been discussed long back in the normal videos. What do you mean by stable equilibrium and what do you mean by unstable equilibrium? Once again, I'll discuss the concept of equilibrium. What do you mean by equilibrium? Equilibrium means the net force acting on that particular charge is zero. If the equilibrium is discussed for entire system, then net force on any charge must be zero. So if you take two point charges Q1 and Q2 like this, between these two there is a point called null point. Already we have discussed it. This null point is a distance x from Q1 and r minus x from Q2. The distance between these two is r. This concept is already discussed, children. That's why I am going little bit fast. So these two are like charges. Then we can find the distance of null point from charge Q1 as r by root of Q2 by Q1 plus 1 from Q. This is already discussed. Okay. Suppose if one of them is negative, so this formula is applicable when the charges are like charges. For like charges. Okay. If they are unlike charges, if one is positive, another is negative, then the formula becomes r by Q2 by Q1 minus 1 from Q1. This is for unlike charges. Okay. So for like charges and for unlike charges, you can find the location of null point if you want. Null point is the point where the net electric field is zero, and here you keep any other charge Q0. This charge does not experience any force. That is the meaning of null point. So at null point electric field is zero, so force is also zero. So whatever the charge you keep here, then this charge does not experience any force. Now, I am going to bring this concept of stable and unstable equilibrium in front of you. I thought before that I would discuss the cases of null point. That's why I had given to you the two formulas. This is for like charges. If both are positive, then null point lies in between them. Null point lies in between Q1 and Q2. If they are unlike charges, if one is positive and another is negative, then null point lies outside Q1 and Q2, means line joining Q1 and Q2. Already these concepts are discussed in the previous videos, and also we had done some numericals also. Now, so null point means an equilibrium point where the net electric field is zero and the force on any charge placed at that point is zero. This is the meaning of null point. Now coming to the system, if there are two charges Q1 and Q2, let us say this is point where the net electric field is zero, I take another charge small q. If I say that this q is only in equilibrium, if I say this q is only in equilibrium, then net force on q is only zero. If I say the system is in equilibrium, the system is in equilibrium, then net force on any charge, any one of them, must be zero. These two also have been discussed earlier in the videos. So if the system is in equilibrium, then net force on any charge is zero. If that particular charge is in equilibrium, then net force on that particular charge is zero. This is the concept behind equilibrium first. Now the question is whether the equilibrium is stable or unstable. That is the concept what we are going to discuss at present. That's why I thought I would discuss the previous concepts also, so that you will understand it in a better way. Now coming to stable and unstable equilibrium, you are given two charges. Listen carefully. Little bit of these concepts also have been discussed in the previous videos. There are two charges, small q and small q. At the midpoint there is a charge q naught, and the distance is L between the two charges. Now they are asking us, discuss the equilibrium of charge q naught. This is the question. Discuss the equilibrium of the charges. So let us say, of course this distance is not necessary for us. How do you say that the equilibrium is stable or unstable? We all know that this point is definitely an equilibrium point, because both the charges are equal. This charge is placed at L by 2 from both the charges, so it is a midpoint. Definitely q naught is in equilibrium. Now the question is whether it is in stable equilibrium or unstable equilibrium. For that, what we have to do, just displace this q naught towards right or left. If you just displace it towards right, what happens? From this position, it has been shifted to this position, let us say. This distance will decrease and this distance will increase. Means distance of q naught from this q will decrease. Distance of this q naught from this q will increase. So the repulsive force between these two increases. The repulsive force between these two decreases. The net force on q naught will be again towards the original equilibrium point. Understand? See, if you displace it towards right, this distance will decrease. We know that force is inversely proportional to r square. As this distance is decreased, this repulsive force, this experiences more repulsive force towards left. Okay. Next, if as this distance is more, this force is less. So this repulsive force is less. So this is less and this is more. As a result, it experiences a net force towards left. That means you have displaced it from this position to this position. You have displaced it from here to here. As a result, it is again coming back to its initial position. So it is coming back to its initial position. So this equilibrium is said to be stable. So for anybody to be in stable equilibrium, if it is displaced from its equilibrium position, if it comes back to its initial position, then that equilibrium is called stable equilibrium. Okay, so what we can conclude, along this line it is in stable equilibrium. So it is in stable equilibrium. Next, someone say that what happens if it is displaced towards left? Okay, no problem, you can take either this or that is up to you. Suppose these two are two charges, at the center we have Q naught charge. This is equilibrium already, because at this point net force is zero. You displace it towards left, so now the charge has come to this position. This distance is decreased and this distance is increased. It is being repelled. It is repelled by this more. It is repelled by this less. This is less. This is more. So as a result, it experiences net force towards right, which is the initial equilibrium position. So you have displaced it towards left. It tries to move towards right. So it is going back to its equilibrium position. So this equilibrium is stable equilibrium. I hope you understood. What I want to conclude from this statement, I want to conclude that, so in this situation, along this line, this point is going to be stable equilibrium position. This is stable equilibrium. Now coming to the another case. In this case, let us take two charges QQ. At the center, there is Q naught. We know that Q naught is equilibrium. Along this line, it is stable equilibrium. That's what we have decided from the last few minutes lecture. Now, someone is asking, what happens if you move it towards upwards? Suppose if it is moved upwards, earlier what we were doing, you were displacing it either towards left or right. Why can't we move it towards up? Suppose if it is moved upwards, what happens? So charge has come to this point. Now these two repulsion, then the resultant of these two is this. So it is experiencing a net force in this direction. That means it will never come back to this point. This Q naught will never come back to, let us say, P, to point P, if disturbed along the perpendicular bisector of line joining Q and Q. I hope you understood this. So along this direction, it is in unstable equilibrium. Along this line, it is in stable equilibrium. You have to remember this concept. This is very, very, very important concept, children. Right? So far, over 7 minutes, we have discussed a simple point that I am going to conclude again. If you take two charges Q and Q, here I take another charge Q naught, which is kept at the midpoint like this. They will ask you, discuss the equilibrium. No need to tell it is an equilibrium. They are asking, discuss the equilibrium, means whether it is stable or unstable. So let us say I take it as x axis and I take it as y axis. Okay, so you can simply write that along x axis it is in stable equilibrium, along y axis it is in unstable equilibrium. Such a simple concept, but unless we discuss it, you will not be able to understand why it is stable, why it is unstable. I hope you understood. Now we just simply change the situation. Same concept, children. I simply change the situation. Earlier what we have taken? We have taken both the charges to be positive. Now we will see what charges we can take. Let us say minus Q and minus Q. Again same. Minus Q and minus Q. Take the midpoint again. This is midpoint. Here it is Q naught. The question is, again, discuss the type of equilibrium, whether it is stable or unstable. What I told you, whether to know it is a stable equilibrium or unstable equilibrium, what we have to do, you have to disturb the charge from the equilibrium position, right? First, along, here I write, along the line joining the charges, along the line joining the charges. Okay, suppose if you displace it towards right, okay, ye charge yahan se yahan aa gaya, yahan aane se kya ho gaya batao na, ye distance, this distance has become less, this distance is decreased. As this distance is decreased towards right, the attractive force will be more, because distance is decreased, attractive force will be more. Why attractive? This is positive, this is negative, that's why there is attractive. As this distance is increased, this attractive force is less. So if you displace this Q naught on the line joining minus Q and minus Q towards right from the midpoint, which was an equilibrium position, towards right, so the attractive, net attractive force will be towards this charge only. So this Q naught charge will not be able to come back to its initial position. So along the line joining the charges, the equilibrium is going to be unstable equilibrium. How simple it is. So just displace it and see whether it is stable or unstable. Another point. Next, take minus Q here, midpoint again. Along this line, we will check whether it is stable or unstable. So, just displace it from this point to this point. This is Q naught. See, this is attracted towards this. Okay. This is attracted towards this, okay. The resultant of these two, if you form a parallelogram, resultant of these two is towards the initial equilibrium position. That means, if you displace it from this to this, along the perpendicular bisector, along the perpendicular bisector, if you displace it from Q naught to this position, along the perpendicular bisector, if you see, the net force is towards the equilibrium. So, it is trying to come back to its initial position. So, this equilibrium is going to be stable equilibrium. I hope you understood this equilibrium cases. So, you may feel that it's quite a boring video, but it is very important, children. Again, I will conclude the condition. What is that? Okay, condition to conclude it. Q naught along this line, stable equilibrium. Along this line, unstable equilibrium. Got it? Got it? Now next. Next is minus Q. Q naught along this line, unstable. Along this line, stable. This is the comprehensive idea about equilibrium and stable and unstable equilibrium cases. Hope you enjoyed it. Okay. Come back. A charge small q is placed at the center of the line joining two charges q comma q. So there is a small charge. There is a charge small q which is placed at the center of the line joining the two charges q comma q. Given that the system of three charges to be in equilibrium. Means entire system is in equilibrium. I will write here, system is in equilibrium. Dekho, condition is very 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 important, children. System is in equilibrium. How to say that system is in equilibrium? It is given already. System is in equilibrium means, it means that net force on any charge is zero, right? Now let us say a charge Q is placed between two charges at the midpoint. Okay, clear? Let the distance be A by 2 and A by 2. Given that system is in equilibrium, I will write here, as the system is in equilibrium, as the system is in equilibrium, net force on any charge is zero. System is in equilibrium, net force on any charge is zero. Let us designate the charges. This is A, this is B, this is C. Take any charge and write the equation for net force on that, equate it to zero, then you will get the magnitude and polarity of the charge. Polarity means sign. Now I'll take charge A. Now tell me, what is the force on? So for instance, I take net force on charge A. A is repelled by this Q in this direction, and even repelled by this Q also in the same direction, which is not possible. But I don't know the polarity of this. That's why I have to take the force as given in the question only. So I go for that. That means force between A and B and force between A and C must be zero. So what is the force experienced by A due to B? 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught Q into Q divided by distance square. You will get A by 2 whole square. I will write directly. A by 2 whole square means I will get A square by 4. I written 4 here. Plus between A and C, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q into Q, that is Q square, divided by the distance between A and C is A. Clear? So it is A square is equal to 0. Now tell me, what can be cancelled? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, take common and cancel it. Next, A square cancel. 1 Q gets cancelled. So I get 4 Q plus capital Q is equal to 0, Q equal to minus Q by 4. How simple it is. So we have obtained the charge that is placed at the center. We have obtained the magnitude as well as polarity of that charge, which is small q equal to minus q by 4. Earlier this question was asked in many entrance examinations. It is very simple question, so you may expect such simple questions in board exams also nowadays. Okay, now I am going to discuss the electric field due to uniformly charged non-conducting sphere. Uniformly charged non-conducting. Non-conducting means what? Non-conducting means it is not a conductor, it is an insulator, right? So if charge is given to a conductor, you give charge to a conductor, it is hollow sphere. Hollow sphere, it is solid sphere, because there is a lot of confusion in the minds of children that if I take hollow sphere, then charge will be distributed on the surface. If I take solid sphere, charge will be distributed throughout the volume. So this I want to give more clarity now. this is hollow sphere and this is solid sphere. Both are conductors. Okay. Again, I am not going to discuss this concept now. I want to give clarity. Both are conductors. One is hollow sphere, another is solid sphere. Though it is solid sphere, just like hollow sphere, the charge will be uniformly distributed on the surface only. No question in this. Because they are conductors. So, in case of conductors, whether it is hollow spherical conductors, whether it is hollow or solid, charge will be distributed on the surface uniformly, and if the radius of the sphere is capital R, then charge density is equal to Q by 4 pi R square. And you can apply Gauss law in order to find the electric field due to this. Now, we had applied Gauss law also in the previous videos while discussing board concepts. I have discussed the applications of Gauss theorem. In that, one of the applications is spherical shell. Hollow sphere is spherical shell only. Now, inside the hollow sphere, inside the solid sphere, electric field is zero. Remember, zero. You say that, sir, this is solid sphere, even though it is zero. Inside the conductor, charged conductor, electric field is always zero. Make it crystal clear. Now the question is non-conducting. So what would happen if it is non-conducting? If it is non-conducting and uniformly charged, charge will be distributed throughout the volume. So there will be volume distribution of charge. Now I take the non-conducting sphere like this, whose radius is capital R, given positive charge which is uniformly distributed throughout the volume like this. So since it is distributed throughout the volume of the non-conducting sphere, so there will be volume charge density rho. Rho is total charge by volume. You have given a charge of Q which is distributed over the volume 4 by 3 pi R cube. Therefore, rho equal to 3Q by 4 pi R cube. Okay, so what is rho here? Rho is the volume charge density. Rho equal to 3Q by 4 pi R cube. Now, first case. In order to find electric field inside the sphere. Okay, inside the sphere, you want to find the electric field. That means, here at a distance small r, you want to find the electric field. When you are finding electric field here, which is inside the non-conducting sphere, r less than r, I need to calculate the charge that is enclosed in this volume. What is the volume of this? What is the radius of this small sphere? Smaller. Now coming to the point. Okay, again we have to go for Gauss theorem only. There is no other goal, children. Only Gauss theorem is the goal. Now, according to symmetry, the field will be like this, radially outwards. Okay, just like Gauss theorem. This is ds area. Normal will be like this. Just go through the previous videos where I discussed the application of Gauss theorem, you will understand. Okay, now according to this, I calculate flux. Flux equal to integral E bar dot ds bar. E bar and ds bar, this is ds, children. Both are parallel to each other. So I will get E into ds under integration. E into, field will be same at any point. because of symmetry, ds is 4 pi r square. It has surface area ds, 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 if I take like this, I get. So, Gauss theorem says that flux through any surface is equal to charge enclosure by epsilon naught. Got it? So, 1 by epsilon naught times charge enclosed. How do I get charge enclosed by this? By this small sphere. To get charge enclosed, I have to go for rho, charge density, into volume of sphere of radius smaller. That will give you charge enclosed by this small sphere, because charge density is equal to charge by volume. Then in order to get charge, you have to multiply it with the volume. So now 1 by epsilon naught times rho into what is volume of the sphere? 4 by 3 pi small r cube. Understand? Now equate these two, you will get the expression. I am going to equate these two. Shall I rub this? Just take a pause here. Take a pause here so that you can note down it. Take a pause. Okay? Right. Now come back to the derivation. This is flux is E into 4 pi r square. Okay, here 1 by epsilon naught rho. Rho means density, 3 cube by 4 pi capital R cube into 4 by 3 pi small r cube. I hope you understood this. Now let us say, let us see now, 4 pi cancel, children, 3, 3 cancel, r square, r cube cancel, I am left with small r here, E equal to q by 4 pi epsilon naught r cube into small r. See how simple it is? So, here field is directly proportional to small r. This is inside the non-conducting sphere. Electric field is directly proportional to small r. Whereas, in case of conducting sphere, inside the sphere, there is no field. But here there is field. In competitive exams, they will give you the same expression in some other format. What it is? This is E inside. Okay. Now I am going to write it. You do one thing. You take this epsilon naught just out. And you take this as 4 pi r cube here. And r by epsilon naught. Right. You multiply it by 3 here. And you multiply it by 3 in the denominator. See, this is rho. What is rho? Charge density. Understood? So, I can write this expression as, understood I think, q by, see, q by 4 by 3 pi r cube is rho. Got it? Take this 3 to numerator. 3 q by 4 pi r cube is rho. This is rho. So, I get rho r by 3 epsilon naught. How simple it is. So inside the non-conducting sphere also there is field, and that field is equal to rho r by 3 epsilon naught, that is directly proportional to small r. This is the only twist. This is not there in board syllabus. This is there in competitive. It is very important for competitive. I hope you understood this. Here let us take a pass. Note down the derivation. Let us take a pass. Note down the derivation. Now, see, here, center, positive charge is uniformly distributed throughout the volume. Here, what is the field? Rho r by epsilon naught, 3 epsilon naught. Here, rho r by 3 epsilon naught, r is variable, right? Here, if you take, on the surface if you take, then in this formula, just substitute small r with capital R. That's all. Now, sir, I want to find the field at center, put r equal to 0. Now, tell me, at the center, what is the field? On the surface, what is the field? Got the point? I'm going to find. First, I will find at the center. So, first case, at the center, small r becomes 0. So, at the center, field becomes 0. Next, on the surface, if it is on the surface, small r equal to capital R, substitute there, on the surface, rho, I have to substitute everything, children, rho, what is the formula for rho? Here I have written 3q by 4 pi r cube, 3q by 4 pi r cube, got it? Next, r, small r, capital R, 3 epsilon naught, okay, then 3 cancel, then this r square times, you see, you are getting again q by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. Means, in Gauss theorem applications, what we have done in board, the same answer. See, on the surface, there is no change. Inside, there is field, rho r by 3 epsilon naught. At the center, it is 0. From center to surface, the field is directly proportional to small r, it increases. Suppose, outside the sphere, if it is asked, that means r greater than r, for outside the sphere points, for points outside the sphere acts as a point charge, your expression becomes q by 4 pi epsilon naught small r square. Now, here, once you take pass and note down this, now I am going to give a graph to you. What is the graph? The graph is like to draw a graph between field and radial distance. Say this, field on y-axis, radial distance on x-axis. This is 0, center, this is surface, and this is outside. Up to surface, we came to know that field is proportional to small r, so it should be a straight line. Here, the field is maximum. How much it is? Q by 4 pi epsilon naught capital R square. This on the surface. R equal to R means surface. After that, means outside the sphere, the field varies inversely proportional to small r square. This is the graph. This graph is also very, very, very important. I hope you understood this also. Okay. Now, I am going to discuss the field due to sheet of charge. From the applications of Gauss theorem, we have learned that if there is a sheet of charge, whether it is positively charged or negatively charged, uniformly charged, at any point the field is sigma by 2 epsilon naught on both sides. Here also sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Right? If it is negatively charged, then it is also sigma by 2 epsilon naught. If it is negatively charged, the field will be sigma by 2 epsilon naught, but direction will be reversed. I hope you understood this. This is not I am going to discuss now. I am going to discuss the case of multiple sheets, which is very important for competitive exams. So, I am given one sheet one sheet, this is another sheet, like this. Very simple, children. Just follow Gauss theorem, you will understand it. I am giving you a logic based concept here. Just try to follow this logic. You will solve this question in 1 minute, right? This is given plus 6q. This is given minus 3q. This is given plus 6q. This is given minus 3q. So there are two sheets. One is given plus 6q. Another is given minus 3q. They are brought close to each other. Now what happens to the distribution of charge? Now they are asking distribution of charge. Now what we have to do? Let us say, let us take the Gaussian surface like this, children. Take the Gaussian surface like this. Okay. Passing through both. What is the total charge on the system? 6q minus 3q, which is equal to 3q. Right? So, here there will be 3q by 2. Here there will be 3q by 2, obviously. So, because these two are identical sheets. So, here total charge is 3q. It must be distributed uniformly. Okay, because they are conductors. So, this side 3q by 2. This side 3q by 2 of the Gaussian surface. This is my Gaussian surface. Now, the question is, on this side, you have mentioned it is 3q by 2. And what is charge on this side? What is charge on this side? That is the question. Now coming to the point, what is the total charge on this earlier? 6q. In that, remove this, subtract this 3q by 2. Okay, 6q minus 3q by 2, I'll get 2, 6 are 12, 12 minus 3, 9, I'll get 9q by 2. 9q by 2. On this side, exactly opposite to this. If it is 9q by 2, here it should be minus 9q by 2. This is the distribution of charges. I hope you understood. I'll be doing another question also, don't worry. So here, initially you have given 6q and minus 3q. How the charge is distributed? Okay. You cannot take, since it is 6q, here it is 3q, here it is 3q. That is wrong, because the influence of this minus 3q also to be considered. So, first, what is the first step? Let us take a Gaussian surface like this, passing through both the sheets. And then, next you calculate the net charge, which is equal to 3q. And distribute the net charge on the two outer surfaces equally. 3q by 2, 3q by 2. Now, go for individual sheet. And this sheet charge is 6q. So, out of 6q, if 3q by 2 appears here, remaining 9q by 2 should appear here. And just opposite to this should appear here. If you want, you can check whether the sum of these two is minus 3q or not. Obviously, minus 9q plus 3q is minus 6q by 2. I am getting minus 3q. So, simple it is. I hope you understood this. Now, I go for another example. I take another example. In this, another example, so I take a charge sheet, charge Q1, I take here as Q2. Just apply the previous concept. What you have to do? Just take the Gaussian surface, passing through these two. What is the total charge? Tell me. Total charge is Q1 plus Q2. What happens? Q1 plus Q2. Half Q1 plus Q2, half here. Now, what is the charge on this? On this side, Q1 minus half Q1 plus Q2 by 2. 2Q1 minus Q1 minus Q2 by 2. You will get Q1 minus Q2 by 2. So, on this side, the charge will be Q1 minus Q2 by 2. And on this side, it is minus half Q1 minus Q2 by 2. This is how the total charge is distributed. Got it? Now I go for another one. I will increase one more sheet. You will understand. I hope you are understanding this. Of course, there is a theoretical approach to this which will kill the time unnecessarily. Let us go for this, it will help you. Next, suppose I take first sheet, second sheet and third sheet. You can take any number of sheets, n number of sheets you can take, no, don't worry at all. And this 6 column, and this 9 column, and this minus 3 column, like this you have taken, right? Now tell me, what is the total charge on the system? 6 plus 9, 15, 15 minus 3, 12 coulomb. So, if you consider the Gaussian surface passing through first and last sheets, okay, the total charge is 12 coulomb. 12 coulomb must be distributed on the two outer surfaces equally, 6 coulomb and 6 coulomb. Got it? Next, if it is 6, this must be 3 coulomb because total is 9. If it is 3, this must be minus 3 coulomb, obviously. Got it? If this is 6 coulomb, the total charge given to it is 6. This on this surface, no charge. On this surface, no charge. This is how distribution takes place. I hope you understood this and I hope you enjoyed this lengthy video and hope you enjoyed it. So please mention your comments in the comment box and like and share if you feel it is useful to you. Right, children? Thank you.